I've grown to make a change. I was different back then, but now I ain't the same. G'day guys, thanks for taking the time to click on the video and check out this amazing interview today. Got the absolute privilege to sit down with a guy who has truly influenced, you know, not just the hundreds and thousands of people across Australia and the world, but personally myself. And you know, I'll speak of no other than Matt Colwell, aka 360. Thanks for taking the time, mate.
Pleasure, mate.
But, yeah, thank you. Yeah, Matt sold millions and millions of records, we'll say. We'll say a couple of albums he went. Well, one went platinum.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah, and double platinum.
Double platinum.
Yeah, but that's not millions.
No. We'll just say millions.
Yeah, millions sounds good.
Sounds heaps better.
I love that.
Yeah. So, mate, I guess we want to catch up today and talk a little bit about you and obviously touch on some music, but more such things like growing up, being a Melbourne lad yourself, you know, what was it like for you, your school life and things like that?
Yeah, so I grew up in Ringwood, which is out east on the end of the train line, and it's quite a rough area, but it's got really nice parts as well. And I was talking to someone the other day how much I really liked growing up there, because you learn to be very street smart around there, and you learn a lot. Like it's no bullshit. It's not like it's some Pleasantville and shit like that. You know, you don't fuck with certain people. You just learn to be wise and shit like that. And yeah, you're pretty much introduced to everything around there. So yeah, high school and primary school was awesome. I really enjoyed high school as well. I didn't finish, but I had fun.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. Did you come across any kind of bullying or anything, mate, in terms of your high school? Or?
Nah. I didn't really get bullied. Not much, no. I was always just a kind of fun-loving dude, and I was friends with everyone. You know what I mean? And I really hated people getting bullied and shit like that. I mean, I had a few people that I had a lot of issues with and between each other, but that's everyone has that in high school. You know what I mean?
Yeah, for sure. Now, right, we spoke earlier about some challenges that you faced and. Yeah, we mentioned that basketball was a big thing for you growing up. Mm-hmm. You had a challenge with your eye. Now, you want to explain what happened there, mate? And I guess basketball and that kind of, how that probably set you back in terms of your dreams and your vision?
Yeah, so basketball is all I wanted to do for my whole life, man. Music wasn't even anything. It was just a little hobby. And basketball was it, you know what I mean? I practiced like before school twice a week, and every night I'd be practicing and have like three games a week, like really intense shit.
Yeah.
And that's all I wanted to do. I just wanted to go play college in America and try and hopefully get in the NBL or the NBA or something. But I don't think I was very good, to be honest. I was just quite tall. But when I was about 19, I noticed the vision in my right eye just started going real blurry and shit like that, and I just shut my eye and just see things in the distance really blurry, and it kind of bugging me out a little bit. And then all these visits to the eye doctor and shit, and all these tests, and they found I've got a disease in my eyes called keratoconus.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it makes your cornea is meant to be like a shape like that, but mine's a cone shape.
Mm-hmm.
So it was just distorting my vision heaps, and it slowly erodes the cornea, so you need to have an operation, otherwise it can pop.
Yep.
So I had to have a cornea transplant in this eye, mm-hmm. which when they did it, and I had like stitches in my eye for about 6 to 8 months, I think, mm-hmm. which they'd just take out every week, which was fucking crazy. Like they'd have to come at my eye with a needle, and it was fully intense as, but yeah, when that was finished, my vision was just gone. Like, I was completely blind in my right eye. So, I can see in my left eye, but it's starting to go shit a little bit. But it's all right at the moment.
Yeah.
So, I've still got vision, but, yeah, it's not very great.
Yeah. So, obviously, that would have stunned you in your tracks pretty much when it comes to wanting to play basketball. Clearly, you need your vision, you know, when it comes to playing any form of sport. But, you know, that would have stopped you.
Man, I was, it yeah. fucked me up. Like, yeah. I was depressed as, you know yeah. what I mean? I didn't know what to do with myself.
Yeah.
I didn't know, because I didn't have a, like, I never thought I was going to have to, like, get a normal job, do that kind of thing. I just wanted to do basketball. That was it.
Yeah.
And so I started to, did an apprenticeship as a chippy, which I fucking hated, but I was just doing it. And it actually turns out that the what happened to my eye turned out to be a blessing, man. Mm-hmm. It, in disguise, because it made me focus on music. Like,
yeah.
it made me actually look at music and start taking it really seriously. And I never thought of it to be a career option at the time, but Pez, who a guy I work with, me, and we've been writing together forever, he was like, man, let's just do this as a career. Like, let's not work a job. We only live once. Mm-hmm. That whole speech, but he really, really drilled it into me, and I was like, fuck, that's a good point. So I quit.
Yeah.
I quit, and I've just been doing music, and then we made it happen.
Ever since. Mm. Yeah. Mate, and then we mentioned before about a go-kart accident that you had.
Mm.
You know, how old were you when that happened?
I think I was 21 or 22 or something like that. Yeah. Or maybe 23, I'm not sure. But it was actually my birthday, and I was in the process of mixing Falling and Flying, and Bliss and Esso wanted to take me go-karting for my birthday.
Yeah.
And I was just very loose at this stage. So I'd had a massive night out, and I was wasted, and then had a little bit of a sleep. I went straight to the Bottle-O, and I bought a bottle of Bacardi and just caught the train out to wherever it was, like out near Campbelltown in Sydney.
Yeah.
And just virtually drunk the whole bottle on the way. And then I got to the place, and I was wasted, and they were like, well, you can't drive because you're so drunk.
Mm.
And I really wanted to drive, but they wouldn't let me, so they made Esso's missus drive, and around the first corner she just went smack into the fence, and I was in a little child seat, and the steering wheel just went smash, and like
yeah.
fucked up my whole shit, you know
yeah,
what I mean,
yeah,
like
yeah, yeah.
tore an artery, lacerated my pancreas and shit like that, and yeah. they had to cut me open, and yeah, lost a lot of blood. It was really, really bad.
Yeah.
And that was really, really bad. Like, I nearly died. Mm. I was in like intensive care for a week or something like that.
Yeah.
And then yeah, that was a big thing to try and recover from.
Yeah, yeah, it would have been. Mm. So obviously those couple of experiences there, mate, it's probably influenced your music.
Yeah.
In a lot of ways.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Definitely, man.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's funny, you know, like, one thing I've learned, especially from the eye thing, like at the time when something really bad happens, like that feels like, you know, your life's over. Like at the time I thought, you know, my life was done, you know, I'm not going to be able to play basketball. Ended up being one of the best things for me, because it made me focus on music. You know what I mean? And I think when I had the go-kart accident, After that happened, it kind of skewed everything that was going on with my album. So I wrote a whole bunch of new tracks, which weren't going to be on the album. They weren't even around. So I reckon they made the album 10 times better. So that was almost a good thing as well. And yeah, you got to try and almost look at any hurdle or any obstacle that at the time it can look like it's just fucked and there's no positive in it.
Yeah.
But you got to try and think that there's going to be a reason for it.
Yeah, sure. Mm. Yeah. Mate, you've obviously, you know, a lot of your music gets listened to by probably a lot of young teenagers and that, young adults across, not just like I said, not just over the world. And what kind of issues do you see that young people face today?
I think it's quite similar to the issues when, I guess, young people when we were growing up, man. I guess it's just getting into drinking and mental illness just seem to be the biggest things, you know yeah. what I mean? And I guess ice is so big now. Like when I was growing up, that wasn't as acceptable as it is now.
Yeah.
And it seems like it's just huge, and that I find that really scary, because I've seen it, what it can do to people.
Yeah.
And it's a fucking turns people into zombies, you know what I mean? It's really, really, really dangerous. So I think that, and I think mental illness, man.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah, sure. What would be your advice, mate, to give to a young person today? Maybe even a 16-year-old Matt Colwell again.
Yeah.
What advice would you give to yourself?
That's a really good question. I've always struggled with being open about how I feel.
Mm-hmm.
I just really, really, really struggle to tell anyone if I'm going through some shit.
Yeah.
Like, especially when I've been fucked up on drugs and been completely addicted, I couldn't tell anyone, man. And yeah. I was hiding it from everyone. Like, everyone knew me as a kind of a very loose kind of party animal.
Mm-hmm.
I was always up for a bender, and that consisted of heavy drinking, a lot of cocaine and shit like that.
Mm.
But people didn't know that behind all that, there was a lot of opiates and painkillers going on to get me through. Like, yeah. Anytime I was coming down or having a hangover or something, I'd be on codeine, or I'd be on Oxycontin or heroin or something like that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And no one knew that. So that's something I hid from everyone for so long.
Yeah.
And if anything, it would be just to be able to be open to, like, your loved ones want to know that you're going through some shit. Like, mm-hmm. they want to be there to help you. I always thought that I didn't want to stress people out. I didn't want to be a burden. And that's not the right attitude. Like, they're even more heartbroken when they find out you've been hiding it and shit like that. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
They want to be there to help you. So try and be open about it. It can be really hard. Like, I still struggle, man.
Yeah.
Even if I'm going through, like, having a shit day or a shit week, I can't talk about it for some reason. I have to write about it.
Yep.
Like, that's the only way I can get it out of me is to write music.
Yeah.
So, I think finding that release, and one thing that's helped me massively is getting a really good psychologist.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's insane how much that has helped. And it took a while too. I tried a few different people and they were always just shit. I felt like they were just going through the motions. They didn't really understand anything I was saying until I found one lady who was just incredible.
Yeah.
And I feel like that, like, anytime I'm having a shit time, I can go to them.
Yeah.
And she will just level me out and make me feel a lot better.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm.
Yeah, good. Yeah, it's something that I can obviously relate to as well. We were speaking before about, you know, we've all got very similar stories in terms of what we've been through. And, you know, speaking up because of your ego and your pride can get in the way, especially if you come from a really, I guess, valued family, you know.
Yeah.
To go to them and say something that seemed weak or whatever it may be, it's bloody hard to do.
Yeah, you know? Totally, man, yeah, totally. And it's funny because me and my brother both have really struggled with the exact same same poison.
Yeah.
Like, me and him, our poison is opiates.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And he struggled too, we didn't even know.
Yeah.
And one day my parents had a gut feeling that something was wrong because he said he was feeling sick, and they just went over there and he was about to kill himself.
Yeah.
And they found him and he was got him, and just from instinct, you know what I mean? That was crazy. So we've been through the same thing, and he finds it really hard to be open about anything he's going through. Yeah.
So obviously that psychologist gives you the opportunity.
Yeah.
No judgment.
Yeah.
Someone there you can just go
totally
dump it all on.
Yeah, man.
Walk away feeling better.
For sure.
Yeah. So I guess your music, coming back to that now, mate, like, what's, you know, obviously Pez come into your life at that stage, and it's formed obviously who you are today in a lot of different ways. But how has music, one, shaped your life? And you spoke before how, you know, when you find it hard to speak about things, you actually write it.
Mm.
That's obviously a clear reflection on the lyrics that are in your music.
Mm.
Is that would be, you know, pretty safe to say?
Definitely, man. I feel like I write my best music when it's saying something. When I'm talking about the pain in that I'm going through or that I've faced, I find it extremely easy to write about that kind of shit. And I really love when artists they share their deep emotions and what's going on. I really, really like that.
Yeah.
So I've always done that, and yeah, I find it extremely easy to be open about it in that sense.
Yep.
But talking about it is kind of hard.
Yep. So what comes first for you? Is it the lyrics and then the music?
I'm always writing, like, if I've without beat.
Yeah.
I'm always writing in my phone, and I'll just come up with random ideas and stuff like that. But when it actually comes time to putting a song together, I've got to hear the music first, because yeah. I've got to know what it's going to be about, what kind of feeling it has, and then piece all the words together.
From there. Yeah, mate, you've collaborated with some pretty awesome people, you know, especially in Australian music, Gosling, Chris Genie, people like that. Who's been the most favourite to work with?
Man, you know, working with Chris Genie and Daniel Johns, man.
Yeah, Daniel Johns, yeah.
Daniel Johns is, he's something else. He's a freak.
Like, just like from an artistic, creative point of view, yeah.
He's like mind blowing. Like, people, I sort of wish everyone could experience just being there when he creates music, because he's just insane, man. Like, you'll put on a beat and he'll just freestyle gibberish. He won't say any words, but he'll sing the melody of how he wants it to sound.
Mm.
And then, however the words, however it sounds, like if it sounds like this word, he puts the words together and it always makes sense. It's really weird, man.
He's
great. Yeah.
Now, mate, mentoring.
Yeah.
So growing up, you know, from the musical point of view, we were talking before about like Eminem, people like that. But even more personally, growing up, did you have some kind of role model or mentor that you?
Being that I was so heavily in basketball, I was always looking up to the older players and shit like that.
Yep.
And I had a bunch of really good role models in basketball. They were really good and really good people. So it was good to be surrounded by them. And it's quite funny, man. I've learned from my psychologist, from, because I went so hard with basketball from probably the age of 7. I was that's all I wanted to do.
Yeah.
But I kind of developed an addictive personality by doing that, because I'm doing it every day. That's all I think about. And so I kind of applied that into everything I do. So
all or nothing.
So if I'm doing music, it's like a drug, man. If I go to the gym, which is a big part of me staying sober, is I go hard, I get obsessed with it and shit like that. Yeah. So everything becomes an addiction, you know what I mean? And if you can just find ways to make that a healthy addiction, then it's fine.
That's good. It's funny you say that, because I'm speaking to my, when I talk to the young people and that, about how football was a drug for me.
Mm.
I found that for 2 hours I could actually go out and perform and train, and no matter what was going on in my life, problems with your missus or finances, whatever they were, none of that shit mattered, you know.
Yeah.
I could focus for 2 hours on a football,
and
it'd just be, you gravitate to like an euphoric feeling during that 2 hours, and then when it's taken away, you're constantly trying to search for something else.
Yeah, man. It's like an outlet, isn't it?
It is, massively. Yeah. Mm. So I can completely understand where you're coming from that. Even the age of 5 and 7, I was the same.
Mm.
Footy, mate. That's all it was for me. Footy.
Yeah.
Yeah, my whole life.
What do you do now? What is it for you now, your outlet?
Yeah, outlet now. So when I went through my stuff, for my psychologist, I was taught coping mechanisms.
Yeah.
So 3 different things that I focus on now. Number 1's been music.
Yeah.
Number 2's family.
Yeah.
And 3's the beach.
Nice.
So I stay on top of those 3, and fitness as well.
So do you surf?
As well. Yeah, well, mum and daddy got a house down Ocean Grove.
Yeah.
So we go down there quite a bit. So we're down there all the time.
Mate. Awesome.
Yeah, I love it. Yeah, absolutely. Awesome. Love it. But I live in Port Melbourne, so get down there, the beach, put my feet in the sand.
Yeah.
Just enjoy that. But family and music, you know, I use the mentality of the whole dehydration thing, you know, using that as an analogy. We always wait until we're dehydrated before we drink water, where it's too late.
Yeah.
It's the same thing when it comes to mental health. You know what makes us happy. So rather wait to get into a state of depression, focus on things that make you happy and consistently do it. It's a self-discipline that's the hardest thing I found.
Yeah.
To constantly do it. We're excited about it early on, and then it can fall away quite quickly. You know, you go back to old habits.
Yeah, but totally.
It's the self-discipline.
Totally.
Yep. So how important is it, mate, to have a role model? You know, all the young people watching this now would, you know, be thinking, oh, some people in my life who they could look up to. You know, how important is that?
I think to be honest with you, man, it's it can be good and it can be bad, because all my role models are people that I looked up to when I was growing up. I looked up to the like Tommy Lee and like all the Motley Crue guys, and they were fucking like just rock stars. Like that's what I wanted to be when it came to music. I wanted to be a rock star.
Yeah.
And that's where I, that's why I started partying so hard, and I just didn't give a fuck because I wanted to be a full rock star. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
So I guess that in that sense, it's probably not very good.
Yeah, yeah.
So I think having, try and find it. If you're going to have a role model, get one that's got good morals and doesn't treat their body like shit, and then you'll be fine.
Good advice.
Yeah.
For sure. What are we doing next? What do we got here? So I want to touch, before we move on from the music stuff, the one song, By All Means.
Yeah.
I just kind of want a background in terms of where that came from, and where you were at and what kind of message you were trying to get across when you were writing that. Now, young people who haven't heard it, jump online iTunes and that and check it out. But By All Means, by yourself, what's behind that?
That was the drugs, yeah. That was me and my brother. It was mainly talking about what me and him had gone through, and sort of talking about it in a. Not very descriptive way, so it's, you don't really know what I'm talking about, but you do, just sort of the things that might have led to it.
Yeah. Another thing, mate, social media.
Mm.
What's your take on that?
God.
Where is that?
I'm no shit, man. Like the social media, and I'm one who I understand I'm a very polarizing kind of artist. Like, I think anyone who suddenly comes out of nowhere and has a real crazy amount of success, I think becomes very hated and very liked, either liked or hated, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I'm someone who cops it online, not so much anymore, but we used to be just out of control, you know what I mean? And when I was really messed up on drugs and stuff like that, I used to be so skinny and really disgusting looking, and the horrible things people used to say, it really fucked with me. Got to me, man. It really did.
Yeah.
Like, I pretend it didn't, and I've developed an extremely thick skin now, so it's kind of fine. But when you're using a lot and drinking a lot, you've got a very fragile mind, so anything can really get to you.
Yeah.
But if you're sober and you know you're healthy and fit, nothing can really get to you.
Yeah, it's it. Yeah. So, I mean, that when you mentioned that just then, song comes to my mind, but I hope you don't mind.
Mm.
Is that
kind
of a reflection on what you just talked about?
Totally. Yeah. And I've never really been too open about this, but I've always struggled with when I was young was you could call it an eating disorder, but I don't think it was like that. I couldn't eat much.
Yeah.
I could never eat much. I was always really skinny and I hated being skinny, but I couldn't eat much for some reason. And I talked to my psych and we figured it out that it's a control thing. If things in my life aren't if I'm not very happy or not very content, I can't eat.
Yeah.
And that was something that happened a lot through my high school years and stuff like that. I just couldn't eat because, you know, it was a way of controlling something in my life. And if it always happens, like even when I go on tour and shit like that, because it can be very draining and very, it's a hard thing to do. By the end of the tour, I can't eat.
Yeah.
And it still happens all the time. So,
yeah. Just with the tour, mate, what's it like?
Walking
out on stage, especially when you come back to Melbourne, and I went and saw your Utopia tour, and it was insane. It was unreal, mate. And I just, as I was watching, I'm thinking, I wonder what it feels like to walk out in the festival hall like that and just have that presence.
Man, it's amazing. It's the best feeling. It really is, especially when, you know, we spent so many years performing to crowds of like 20 people or 50 people before we were anything, you know. You got to put in those years of work where you're performing to no one just to try and get your name out there, and you learn how to perform that way though. You learn, even if there's 50 people in the crowd, you learn how to control those 50 people and how to make it funny and shit like that. But it is an amazing feeling. I reckon anyone watching, anyone can do it. Like if I can do it, I'm just a normal dude from Ringwood, just decided to do it one day, and anyone can do it.
Yeah, here we are.
Yeah.
Yeah. What's next, mate, for you?
I've been writing like crazy. I've got heaps of new shit to come out. I've been working on the album with Pez, the Forthright album, and he's got his solo album coming out, but I've been also been acting as well.
Okay,
I've got my first feature film coming out pretty soon and some other stuff in the works.
Yeah. So where's the acting side come from? Just something you've wanted to get into?
Something I've always wanted to get into, man, I'm really, really passionate about it, but never been given the opportunity, and suddenly I got hit up about a role for this movie coming out called Is This the Real World, and I was like, I'd love to do that.
Yeah.
So I started, and it was a lot of fun, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I'm really into that at the moment.
Yeah, awesome. Mm. Last question, mate. All the girls I keep asking me to tell you, is there a Mrs. Colwell on the scene at the moment?
No, there's nothing.
There's
man.
Nothing going on?
There's nothing.
Just keeping to yourself.
It's weird, man. It's so strange because I don't know. Like, people think, you know, you're 360, you'd be able to get whoever you want.
Yeah,
and it's not the case.
Somewhere like
no, I don't know where.
So you're not on Tinder?
I am on Tinder.
On Tinder?
I am.
There you go.
I have used it occasionally, man. It's quite fun. It's quite hilarious.
It is.
I actually don't know where to meet females, man. So if you're a nice girl and you're single and you see me, approach me. I'm down.
Yeah. Get it done. Well, mate, honestly, from obviously we spoke before and how important it was for me to come today and meet you. And from a personal point of view, yeah, I was that excited the last few days, and I just can't thank you enough for taking the opportunity, mate, to sit down with us and share more about yourself and what's next for you. And I'm sure everyone out there looks forward to it.
Man, pleasure.
Good stuff.
Pleasure. Awesome to meet you, man.
Yeah, you too. Cheers. Thanks, mate.